So guys, today I'll be telling you about the history of cells. So knowing the history of cells is very important in life, as we don't give much emphasis to others or inform people about it, but in real life it's actually very important to know what its history or history of microorganisms says. So starting with the history of cells, first person whom I like to remind you all is Robert Hooke. So what did he do? He was the first person who said that all living beings are composed of cells. He was an English naturalist and architect who had first informed that all living beings are composed of cells. He coined the word cell to describe what he saw while viewing tree bark from a cork oak. He used two lens microscope, and he began the concept of cell theory. Next person whom I like to remind you all is Anton van Leeuwenhoek. Who invented what? He invented microscope. And we all know how this thing is important to all of us. The term microscope, which had been invented by Anton van Leeuwenhoek, firstly described that he could see cells under a 10x scope or 2x scope with the help of zooming the thing which is kept under the thing. So he was a Dutch fabric merchant. He was the first person to accurately describe living microbes. He used a simple microscope, which is made up of like simple lenses and magnifying glasses. And he used samples of rainwater, own feces, and scraping from own teeth. He was a very important person to introduce this microscope, which is used in all labs and schools and colleges today. So the next person whom I like to say is Francisco Redi. Francisco, who with the help of three-jar experiment explain the cell theory, which I'll explain you a little bit later in this video. So starting with the next thing, which is the spontaneous generation, how the cells came into life, how the cells came into human living things. Examples such as toads, snakes and mice, which are found in moist soils, and examples such as flies and maggots, which are mainly present in manure and decaying flesh. These cells develop from the moist soil and the manure and decaying flesh, which are present all over the entire place. Entire earth is composed of that, and these microorganisms or cells arise from them. In these spontaneous generation there are some myths. There are some wrong sayings which we all consider even today. Like some of them say that snakes from horsehair in stagnant water, mice are found from grains and cheese wrapped in a sweater, like maggots from rotting meat and fleas from men, and lots of them which are like flying from here and there, and that are actually myth. That are just rumors spread by early scientists who like considered things which would assume to them a simpler and easier, but in real world today we know that are not possible, obviously. So these myths, obviously, why do people believe myth even today? So there are some reasons, because these were supported by extremely learned scientists such as Aristotle, John Needham, Lazzaro Spallanzani, who conducted a few experiments to conclude them. So as I told you, this the experiment conducted by Francisco Redi, named three-jar experiment. He took three jars, firstly sealed. He firstly made some of them sealed and some of them open, and jars were covered with fine nets of prevention of maggots and flies. So one of them was kept open, this net was covered. One of them was airtight, one of them was partially airtight. So the lid which was opened, and there was some piece of flesh kept in each of the flasks. So in first flask, the flesh was eaten by all the maggots which had come in the open jar. So it was all covered and all destroyed, eaten by them. The second jar, which was the first, second and the third. The second jar which was partially covered was which had been contaminated half by maggots and partially contaminated. But the third jar, which was airtight sealed, had no maggots inside the jar. So it concluded that air was the medium for microorganisms, and he thus from this experiment said that air was the medium or vehicle for formation of microorganisms in this real world. So he was somewhat right in saying them. So the next scientist I like to mention you all about is John Needham. Who introduced the term heat nutrient broth. Heat nutrient broth is something in which broth is created from an inoculum and is heated so that the contamination present in it are destroyed. Next scientist I'd like to mention you about is Lazzaro Splananzani. Who conducted an experiment known as sealed heated broth, which I'll come to terms a bit later in the video. Broth. Next scientist, or one of the most important scientists, was Rudolf Virchow. Who said that? Who introduced the term known as microgenesis, which means that organisms arise from new or living or microorganisms or cells arise from non-living beings, which was a very big thing and like quite unbelievable from the ages of that people. So next is Louis Pasteur. Who conducted an experiment known as Swan Neck experiment, which was a turnaround in the history of biology. So next I'll explain you this Swan Neck experiment. So what is this term known as Swan Neck experiment? So what Louis Pasteur did was he trapped airborne organisms in cotton. He also heated the necks of flasks, drawing them out into long curves, sterilized the medium and left the flask open to the air. So no growth was observed because dust particles carrying organisms did not reach the medium. Instead, they were trapped in the neck of the flask. If the neck were broken, dust particles would settle down and organisms would grow. In this way, Pasteur disapproved the theory of spontaneous generation, you know. So there was a Swan Neck flask just like this. Okay. So shape of the flask allowed air in vital force but trapped dust particles because it was like narrow. So they allowed air to pass through it but trapped dust particles due to its narrow opening, okay, which may contain obviously microbes. So this was something which was new to everyone, as he proved it through an experiment. So the next topic I would like to say about is Tyndallization. What is Tyndallization? So there was a scientist named John Tyndall. It was the most breakthrough period of biology when John Tyndall introduced the term Tyndallization. So, what did John Tyndall? What does Tyndallization mean? So, Tyndallization is something which is formed from infusion prepared for meat and fresh vegetables kept in boiling water for 5 minutes. Showed no growth of animals because it was very evident that as it was like freshly prepared and kept in boiling water, which killed all the microorganisms present in it. He also did one more thing, which was he dried hay, which did not show this sterilization even after 1 hour or around 5 to 5.5 hours of boiling. He dried hay, he dried hay, which had spores which were resistant to heats, which was like quite a new thing for all of us. He showed that animals had 3 phases of growth. It was thermolabile and thermoresistance. What are these two terms, thermolabile and thermoresistance? Thermolabile are organisms which are like quietly affected by temperature, and thermoresistance are which can even survive in higher temperatures or lower temperatures. So this was something which was new to the industry of biology and microorganisms, and John Tyndall was the one who introduced or like mainly proved that cells don't arrive from non-living beings. Cells arrive from decay matters and like different sort of processes like which are present all over the earth. So that's it from the history of cells. So I'll explain the next part of that microorganism part in the next video. Hope you watch this soon.